Marlies, Marvin here from techbrawl.com, where we do unboxings, reviews, and sexy b-rolls. And today, it's finally happening, guys. I'm building my first mini ITX build with specifications that I was only dreaming about before. So huge thanks to ASUS ROG and ADATA XPG for sponsoring this build, providing me with better overall experience when it comes to 4K video editing and 1440p gaming. And of course, this build will not even happen without your support, guys. So I'm going to give back to you by giving away one ASUS ROG gaming mouse at the end of this video. With that being said, let's get into it. So the reason why I want to build a new PC other than having a better overall workstation is that I want to have a dedicated open test bench for reviewing PC components for you guys. So the idea is I'm going to use this new PC as my main workstation and then I'm going to use the old one for my open test bench. So yeah, so let's start off with all the components that we're going to use for this build. For the motherboard, we're going to use the ASUS ROG Strix X470i Gaming, which is quite featured packed on such a tiny small form factor like this. So inside the box, we have the motherboard itself, a cable mode discount code, a user manual, the I/O shield, a compact disc, yes, a compact disc guys, zip ties, a handy front panel extension cable, a 3-pin RGB connector, 4 SATA cables, the Wi-Fi antenna, some screws for the M.2 slots, a special thank you card from ASUS ROG, and a bunch of ROG stickers. So as you can see, you have everything you need inside this package. As for the motherboard itself, we also have everything we need. We have an HDMI port just in case you want to use an APU. We have 4 USB 3.1 Gen 1 ports, 2 USB 3.1 Gen 2 ports, an Ethernet port, and we also have a built-in Wi-Fi and Bluetooth 4.2 connectivity, which is important for a form factor like this, especially if you're building an HD PC. We also have audio jacks with fancy LED illumination, a single PCIe slot for the graphics card, an audio combo card, and underneath it we have one M.2 slot with another one behind the motherboard. For headers, we have one 3-pin addressable RGB header, one 4-pin RGB header, two fan headers, one AIO header, one USB 3.1 Gen 1, one USB 2.0, four SATA connectors, front panel audio connectors, and a couple of sensor connectors. So yeah, it's safe to say that this tiny motherboard doesn't compromise anything when it comes to connectivity and features even on a very small form factor like this. Now for the processor, we're going to use the AMD Ryzen 7 3700X with 8 cores and 16 threads. And initially, I was just planning to get the 3600X, but then again, I figured if I'm gonna do an upgrade, it should be quite significant, and I believe the 3700X is a good balance when it comes to price to performance ratio without going over the top like with the Ryzen 9 processors. This should provide us with decent performance for 4K video editing, and quite frankly, was on the limit of my budget, so there's that. So inside the box, we have the processor itself and the Red Prism stack cooler with RGB illumination. Now for the memory, we're going to use the XPG Spectrix D60G, and what we have here is the 16GB kit with up to 3600MHz frequency, which is good for 3rd-gen AMD Ryzen processors. And what I like about this is the design with probably the largest surface area for RGB illumination on a RAM that I've seen. It is absolutely beautiful as you can see on this image preview. At the back of the box, we have the specific technical details here, certifications, and other supplementary info. So inside the box, of course, we have the memory modules themselves, and at first look, it is definitely stunning. By the way, I'm going to do a separate video review about this, so make sure to subscribe so you won't miss out. For storage, of course, we're going to use the current bang for the buck NVMe right now, which is the XPG SX8200 Pro, and what we have here is the 512GB variant. Now, XPG generously provided me with one, and I decided to buy another to maximize the storage space on our build. This is actually very popular because it provides consumers with great performance at a fraction of the cost against its competitors. I'm also going to make a separate video about this for a more in-depth discussion about its benefits compared to my old system. So inside the box, we have the NVMe itself, and it also includes a heatsink, which is very convenient. And now for the graphics card, we're going to use the ASUS ROG Strix 2070 Super Advanced Edition, and to be honest, I have never imagined that I will have a powerful graphics card like this. So huge thanks to ASUS ROG for the assist. For the OG subscribers out there, you already know guys what graphics card I used when I first did a PC build back in like 2018. Comment it down below if you remembered it. But yeah, this graphics card should provide us with decent performance for both 4K video editing and 1440p gaming at ultra settings for most titles, so I'm very happy with this. So inside the box, we have a small accessory box right here. Inside it, we have all the necessary paperwork. Removing the top foam cover reveals the actual graphics card itself. And here, we usually have a couple of ROG Velcro straps.
Alright, so at first look and touch, this graphics card is massive, heavy, and feels really premium. Of course, we have the patented ROG Strix design with Axial Tech fan design and overall robust frame and construction. At the top side, we have the large GeForce RTX branding, a small Strix logo, and an illuminated Republic of Gamers logo right here. We also have the two 8-pin power connectors and the massive heatsink throughout the entire graphics card and some reinforcement design elements. So as you can see, the card itself is thick and will consume 2.7 PCIe slots. At the back, we have the massive backplate with of course a massive ROG Eye logo, an LED on and off switch, and with an overall gamey redesign all over the backplate. At the side, we have a few fan and RGB headers which are really nice especially for a mini ITX build like this. And all over at the other side, we have the ports. We have a USB Type-C, two HDMI ports, and two display ports. Now, all of these components will go inside the InWin A1 Mini ITX chassis with a built-in 600 watts power supply. Now, what I like about this chassis other than the small form factor is the quite simple design with substantial features like wireless charging support, tool-less side panel removal, and RGB underglow with a sort of floating effect. This will fit right in on the minimalistic look that I'm going for my desk setup.
Alright guys, with all the components introduction out of the way, let's finally build this, shall we?
Alright guys, so building inside the InWin A1 to be honest is quite challenging. I cannot count how many times I had to remove the motherboard and route the cables and whatnot. And my advice if you're going for the same chassis is plan ahead of time. And I guess that's already a given for any mini ITX build since the space is quite limited. Thankfully, the I.O. shield of the ASUS ROG Strix X470i Gaming has this soft cushion that protects the ports whenever I had to reinstall the motherboard. So yeah, you'll have to plug in all the cables beforehand like the RGB connectors, fan connectors, CPU and motherboard connectors, and even SATA, HD audio and other connectors before you place the motherboard inside the case. Because after the fact, you no longer have access to those headers and ports. Now, another thing that I appreciate with the Strix X470i motherboard is that it has this front panel extension. So plugging in your power button, LED indicators and whatnot is super easy. By the way, I also decided to flip the fan on the side from exhaust to intake as suggested by one of my friends for better airflow as per the experience of other InWin A1 users. Speaking of fans, I use 3 ID Cooling DF12025 and 1 Bisky fan as an exhaust. The ASUS ROG Strix 2070 Super also barely fits inside the case, but once inside, it looks damn good because it spans across the entire case, which I think adds to the overall cramped aesthetic of this mini ITX build. And as you can see, cable management is quite decent as well with no cables choking the airflow, which is very good. I also like the look of the Rate Prism stock cooler with individual customizable zones for the RGB lining, AMD logo, and the fan blades. However, I'm planning on replacing this with a 120mm AIO once the community quarantine is lifted. As for the XPG Spectrix D60G RAM, although you barely see its overall aesthetics here because of the cramped space, you still have this nice RGB illumination on top of it that adds up to the overall design element of the build. The RGB underglow of the InWin A1 also looks good and gives this sort of floating case illusion and complements well with the ASUS ROG Strix 2070 lying on top of it cooled by two case fans underneath it. So yeah, build experience is not the best with lots of trial and errors, but only of course if you didn't plan ahead like me, so experience will definitely vary. But once done, the build is absolutely gorgeous with substantial RGB illumination and for the most part, clean cable management.
Alright guys, before we end this video, let's talk about the performance.
Let's start off with the Ryzen 7 3700X processor in comparison with my old PC with Ryzen 5 2600X. In Cinebench R15, The 3700X gets ahead a little in single-core performance but blasted away in multi-core performance with up to 56% improvement. The same scenario is observed in Cinebench R20 with up to 59% improvement. Now, in Blender's built-in BMW benchmark using CPU power, the new PC with 3700X was able to finish the task for only 2.93 minutes, while the old PC with 2600X took about 4.6 minutes. On the other hand, using the GPU power, the new PC with 2070 Super finished the task for only 0.88 minutes, while the old PC with 1070 took about 1.76 minutes. So that's actually a significant improvement. And now for our real-world performance test for video editing in Adobe Premiere Pro, with our standard 14-minute 4K video project, the new PC was able to finish rendering previews for only around 5.77 minutes, while the old PC took around 8.83 minutes. And for the actual exporting of the project using our standard 4K constant bitrate preset, the new PC was able to export the video for only around 24.86 minutes, while the old PC took 10 minutes more for about 34.63 minutes, and in my opinion and work efficiency in mind, that is a lot of time that I can spend on other things like editing thumbnails and whatnot, so this is actually a quite significant increase in performance, and I am very happy with it.
And now for gaming, here are the rest of the benchmarks.
So as you can see, there is a huge leap when it comes to gaming performance upgrading from 3600X and 1070 to 3700X and 2070 Super. And the higher frequency of 3600 MHz for the RAM, of course, helped with the increase in performance as well. And as per these results, we are good even at balls-to-the-wall settings at 1440p gaming.
Alright guys, I know a lot of you are wondering about the temps on this new Mini ITX build, so let's talk about that.
I've actually tested the temps in different scenarios throughout our benchmarks, so let's start with Blender. So in Blender's built-in CPU benchmark, the CPU's temps spiked at around 83.8 degrees at max, and while that is alarming for some, take note that our average temperature is only around 51.7 degrees, so we're still good. As for the 2070 Super using the same Blender benchmark but using the GPU, the ASUS ROG Strix 2070 Super was super chill. Get it? Super? Averaging only 33 degrees because the test actually took only 53 seconds. Now in Cinebench R20, the 3700X with the Raid Prism Stack Cooler again spiked around the 80s at max but only averaged around 69.2, so that's still pretty decent. And now for gaming, the 3700X spiked at around 77.6 at max with an average of only around 56.3, while the 2070 Super is again super chill with a maximum temp of around 55 and with an average of only around 40. And now for video editing in Premiere Pro, which is what I'll be using this PC for most of the time, with a total of 24 minutes export time which gives us an idea of a long-term max load performance, the 3700X spiked at around 84.5 at max with an average of 73. While our 27 Super graphics card remains cool with a max temp of only around 43 and with an average of 39. And as you can see on these benchmarks, our idle temp is around 38 to 42 degrees, and that is with a relatively low ambient temperature of 30 degrees, and with all transparency achieved by controlling the temperature using an AC, because there is no way I can control the ambient temperature with our hot climate here in the Philippines. So yeah, this is with the InWin A1 chassis being closed, and I think the temperature is pretty decent, but definitely has a lot of room for improvement, especially with the processor steps. So I'm really excited to get a hold of a 120mm AIO once the quarantine period is lifted.
Now for kicks and giggles, here's a bonus comparison as I find this really interesting.
As you can see, the 3700X inside a closed InWin A1 case is cooler compared to the 2600X in an open test bench. I think it's something to do with their stock cooler, with the Raid Prism having a better performance compared to the Raid Spire. Let me know in the comments below what you think about this. Now I'm really impressed with the performance of the ASUS ROG Strix 2070 Super. It remained relatively cool on all the tests that we threw at it and provides decent performance even at 1440p resolution at very high to ultra settings. The ASUS ROG Strix X470i motherboard is also quite good with intuitive BIOS and a bunch of features and with the substantial ports and connectors in a tiny form factor. The XPG Spectrix D60G worked flawlessly out of the box at its rated 3600MHz frequency and timings by just setting the DOC profile in BIOS. The XPG SX8200 Pro NVMe also provided a delightful experience as my first ever NVMe drive, and I'm never going back to SATA SSD as a boot drive from this. Of course, the AMD Ryzen 7 3600X is such a great upgrade from your old AMD Ryzen 5 2600X and is definitely worth the savings. As for the InWin A1 case, I'd say it looks good but has a lot of room for improvement in terms of overall build experience.
Alright guys, like I said, I'm going to give away one ASUS ROG Harrier GT300 gaming mouse, and all you have to do is follow the link below.
Aside from that, you can also join the ongoing Rave for ROG campaign for a chance to win premium ROG items. More details on the link below as well. So to conclude, if you're looking for a powerful gaming and video editing in a small form factor, whether for gaming and video editing on the go, or if you're just like me who simply wants a more minimalistic desk setup, then this PC build that we have right here is a good option. It has a mix of very good components that will set you back around 90,000 pesos or $1,760 if you add a 120mm AIO, which I suggest you do for better thermals, and I will do so once shipping is back to normal. And as per our benchmarks, this build is quite substantial for decent 4K video editing as well as gaming at 1440p with very high to ultra settings.
And there you have you guys. Thank you for watching. Make sure to check the full article link below. Huge thanks to all of you guys for your support and to ASUS ROG and the DataX PG for sponsoring this build. I leave a link below to all the components that were used on this video so that you can check it out. Special thanks to Sir Tom Bermer, by the way, for some valuable tips for this build, and you can check out his channel for more builds in different price categories. Thank you for watching, subscribe if you like this, and see you next time. Have a great day, guys.